Hey everyone, it's Jonathan, and welcome back to Wonderland Wednesday. Ever since I reviewed the Disney versions of Alice in Wonderland back in 2022, I've wanted to finish out the rest of Disney's attempts at Alice. The ones we talked about back then were just the theatrical releases. There are still at least three more Disney takes on Alice in Wonderland, all TV shows. My friend and fellow Alice fan Jenna, aka Phantomwise, will be joining me to talk about this last batch of Disney adaptations? Adaptations in heavy quotations. Starting with the most recent, and in fact still airing, TV show, Alice's Wonderland Bakery. Well, this show ended up being pretty much exactly what I figured it would be. Which is to say, I didn't go in with high hopes of it being very entertaining, and I was pretty correct. It did get better as it went on, though, the more episodes I watched, but I think I was just getting used to it.
I think we kind of have similar experiences with this, because, well, I'm a little bit more dramatic, so my first thought when I saw this was going to be a thing, I was like, ew, no. That was my, like, first experience. Though I knew in the back of my mind, it probably wasn't that bad, but just for some reason, looking at, like, the designs and the characters and just the way it looks, it's kind of like that manufactured corporate feeling, like, oh, this is like the ultimate appeal for kids.
Uh-huh.
And something about me that's about that just drew me off instantly. I didn't like how it looked. And then I think I watched like one episode and I was like, yeah, I don't care for like this. And then you asked me to do this podcast, and I was like, all right, time to give it more of a fair shake. And it's not as bad as you would, you know, as I feared it would be. It's kind of like you ever go into a pool the first time and it's really, really cold. And
that probably is a good analogy.
Yeah, and you force yourself in the pool. It's like, okay, it's not as bad as I thought it was going to be, but I still don't like it in here. That's the show for me.
That's probably my feelings too. Like at the very beginning, I watched the first episode and I was like, I am so bored. I don't want to sit through any more of this. But then I was like, I'm doing a podcast. I really need to do my due diligence. And then I started skipping around looking for specific characters when they showed up. And the more I watched, the more I was like, okay, this isn't as bad. I still would not choose to watch this in my own free time. But like, if I had a little kid and they wanted to watch it, it's fine.
If I had a child, I wouldn't mind them watching this.
Yeah.
Personally, though, I actually do like kids' shows. So, like, you know,
well, I like some. Like, but yeah, this one, it just seemed too simplistic and not enough in the spirit of Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah. See, it's. I think I wrote something about that. I said I don't like the overly professional look of it. I didn't know how else to put it, but just kind of that corporate made by committee. I don't even know why I'm being judgmental about that, because obviously everything is made by committee, but and this kind of thing, but it's like it's technically perfect, but something's off about it.
I think I know what you mean, because like a lot of versions, a lot of movies, the more they are made by one person who has a vision and they really want to make this thing, the more genuine it feels. And this feels does not feel genuine at all. It just feels like they're trying to make a show for kids. They're trying to make it appeal to kids as much as possible. And they don't have one singular vision for the show. They're just like, let's make an Alice in Wonderland themed cooking show for kids.
I don't know. That's where I'm kind of like, I think there is a theme here. Whether it's a good theme is, you know, questionable or not. I did actually look a little bit into the production, because at some point, I might bring it up later, but at some point something made me curious about like what the show was supposed to include. So basically it's this idea, if I remember correctly, I'm paraphrasing, the idea of baking and cooking, which in the show is kind of goes hand in hand. Even though baking is technically, you know, a little different from like just plain on cooking. But anyway,
Yeah.
the idea that food brings people together, and it also shows it's a way that different people in different cultures are similar to each other because we all eat, we all like good food, but we also have differences. The idea is that Alice and her friends are all like different cultures and ethnicities and species. So they all like different things and they share recipes with each other, which isn't a bad idea. I just don't know what it has to do with Alice in Wonderland. Yeah, so
Exactly.
it's kind of, it's kind of like, you read that. It's like, that's not a bad idea for a children's show. I just don't understand why Alice. And I think also, like, it also makes it a little weird too, because there's a lot of fantasy elements in it. A lot of these ingredients are fantastical.
I was going to say that too, because there's like they use, like you said, fantastical ingredients, but then they also try and incorporate real world. Like there was an episode later on, I don't know if you watched it or not, where they use yuzu fruit, which is a real fruit. But like in America, what kid is going to know that yuzu is a real fruit? They're just going to think it's a fantasy element.
Yeah, I
Because
didn't see that
it
episode.
looks like a weird lemon. It's a type of citrus, but like it's kind of mixed in with all these other fantasy things. So you're not really teaching kids about new foreign real world ingredients. It just kind of blends in with like the doorbell
The
peppers or
fantasy
whatever.
elements. Yeah. And I think that's a good point. Things that are real can get lost in the shuffle of the fantasy elements. And there's not really anything to differentiate it. So I don't know. I would say a lot of kids' show might have, like, it's not just Alice's Wonderland Bakery. A lot of kids' shows might have that kind of, I don't know if I want to say a problem, but that concept, like, I don't know, boundary issue. I don't know what to call it. But like, even I love Adventures in Wonderland, which I hope to talk about at some point, but even they kind of like mix real elements in with fantasy elements. So that's always kind of a thing in children's shows, but I feel like this one like really mixes it up, where it could be confusing.
Yeah. 'Cause like I haven't watched Adventures in Wonderland since I was a kid, but I guess I would assume that whatever they're mixing up would probably be American English stuff. Like they're not trying to teach about foreign cultures
Oh, there's a few
in
episodes
that.
where they do.
Oh, okay.
Not as
Well,
much
maybe
as
it's a
this show.
similar
I will say
issue.
this show does it a lot more. But I don't know. I don't know if I want to say, like, we'll teach about cultures you can't involve fantasy at all. But
Well, I
I
don't think that I
yeah.
don't think it's inherently a problem. I think the way that they did it in here could confuse the issue because they didn't differentiate, like with the yuzu. It wasn't like they pointed it out and said, this is a real fruit that you could actually try if you wanted to go to like an Asian market and buy a yuzu. It was just one of the things that they were buying alongside all of these other fantasy things.
Yeah, that's a good point. It could have been simple as, oh, Alice saying, oh, I think we have this kind of fruit back home or something.
Yeah.
Did you do that?
I don't think so. Because they were making something called calamity soup, and it was a whole bunch of, it was mostly not real things. Or were they making it at that? I don't know. The whole episode is kind of mixed up in my head. A lot of these episodes are getting mixed up in my head because
Yeah.
they all kind of ran together.
I mean, as long as we're on the subject of the food, I just want to bring up, like, the structure of the show is very off. I don't know. It kind of bothers me a bit, of where literally it's about like two recipes every episode usually. Some episodes are not, but that's usually part of it is that it's about recipes. And it feels so weirdly forced to me. It's like
Kinda.
everything has to be about food and a recipe solves everything. And I'm
Yeah.
like, why? Can't Alice run a bakery and so, obviously there's food, but does it need to be like the does it need to be the vocal point of each episode. It's just, I don't know, it's a little too structured for me in a weird way.
Yeah, I know what you mean. And I think, again, this comes back to why does it need to be Wonderland? Because I was watching it and I was thinking, if I'd had a show like this as a kid, I would have wanted to make these recipes. Like, I like cooking. I liked cooking back then too. But because they're fantasy recipes, you can't make them. And I feel like if this was a more realistic show, even if a cartoon, they could have used a real recipe. And then whether or not they publish a cookbook, they could have had the recipes available online for parents to go and make with their kids. But you really can't when you're using things like doorbell peppers or whatever fantasy kind of ingredient that's sort of real but not really real. I don't know.
Yeah, I feel like there might have been a way to differentiate it too. As far as I saw, Alice never made food from the real world at all.
They talked about doing it, but it always incorporated ingredients from Wonderland. Like there were episodes. Like, did you ever see any with the Caterpillar family?
Which one?
The Caterpillar family. The caterpillars are Persian,
No,
so it would
I
have
didn't
been
see any
Middle
of those.
Eastern food, and they had a real world recipe called cuckoo, but I'm fairly certain that they used fantasy ingredients for part of it, and I'm not sure they even gave the entire full recipe. I feel like they were just using the show to introduce the idea of different kinds of foods, but I feel like they could have gone taken it a step further and like actually talked about how the foods are made. 'Cause like I said, as a
Yeah, that's a good
kid, I
point.
would have loved learning like how these recipes are actually made. And instead you have ingredients like pineapple upside down powder, which turns your cake upside down and puts it on the ceiling.
Yeah, I feel like I don't know. I'm thinking of like stuff like Sesame Street, where they actually sometimes show real kids
Yeah.
like doing something,
Yeah,
and
like
I feel
Mr.
like maybe that
Rogers.
would have gone a long way,
That was one of my
like
favorite
if.
things watching Mr. Rogers was like actually seeing how things were made, like in real
Yeah.
world settings. Not that this
Yeah.
has to be that exactly, but I feel like they could have done a better job in making this educational rather than sprinkling something slightly educational, but also it's mixed with fantasy, so you can't really tell the difference.
Yeah, I don't know. If I was making this show and for some reason I decided to do this, I wouldn't do the show, but if I for some reason I was, I'd probably have a little segment at the end showing like real kids cooking and just be like, well, you can't make wonder cake like we can, but you can make a cake like this. And
That's a good idea. There are other PBS shows that would do similar things.
it's just, or even like, oh, I was inspired to make my Wonderland recipe off this recipe, showing a real world one. And I feel like that would have gone a long way.
Yeah, it would have.
Especially for the diverse foods, like showing like the actual diverse foods.
Yes.
And the cultures they come from is, like again, in the show, yes, you see the characters and they're diverse, but you're seeing a fantasy representation of a culture and not the actual culture.
Yeah.
So that would have been a bit nice to see the actual culture represented at the end or something, but I don't know. And again, I don't really see the point. It's almost like mashing up two concepts, I guess, of
Yeah.
let's use food to show diversity with let's have some fantasy show, and then you smush it together and it made this. And I don't know if the results are what they wanted.
I feel like your idea of a live action segment at the end could have solved the bulk of my issues with the show.
Yeah, I think I solved my own issues with this, so yeah. I also think personally, I'm not too fond of the two stories per episode kind of gig, as I feel like you could focus more on the characters and how they respond to issues and how they resolve it. But because they so strictly adhere to that structure of we need to do a
Yeah.
recipe to solve our problem, it doesn't work out that way. So it's, I don't know, that's how I'd fix the show. It'd be one story per episode. focusing more on actual resolutions instead of magic recipe solving. Recipes would be involved, but it wouldn't be the bulk of how they solve the problems. And then, yeah, real life segment.
Yeah, I think the two episodes per episode are probably just something required for the half hour format on television. But I
I don't
kind
know.
of feel like
There's
the.
shows without that. Like I love to watch Sophia the First. That's an example of a Disney Channel show where they don't do that.
Okay. Well, I know a lot of kids' shows, and even some that are all ages, will have two episodes per half hour. But I feel like that shouldn't be a requirement in the age of streaming.
Yeah, I don't know. I've never been fond of that because I grew up with shows like that with two stories per episode. But I don't know. I've always preferred longer episodes, so that might just be me. That might be a me thing.
I always did too.
I feel like in this show in particular, it does kind of make it its own detriment because, like, instead it's about finding a recipe that will solve the problems for the most part. And I don't know. It just hits weird. I don't like it. I don't feel like it's actually teaching things about relationships and yeah, I don't know, it's supposed to be about like families and stuff, right? Too, and people, diverse people. I don't feel like we're actually getting that. I feel like we're you know, it's just here's some food that has some fantastic elements that you can't find in real life. It's okay, thank you. I'm really learning a lot, I swear. And I feel like you're not learning much.
I was just going to say, I feel like it's supposed to be an educational show, but I don't know how educational it actually is at the end of the day.
Yeah, it's supposed to be edutainment, and I love edutainment. This ain't it.
Because I don't feel like I learned anything new, and I really don't think a kid is going to feel like they learned anything new.
I mean, I don't go into kids' shows expecting to learn things new. I enjoy children's media in general, though, because I like to see how they bring up conflicts and how they explain them to a child, and how they resolve those conflicts. Which some shows do really well, and then some shows don't, which again, we'll talk about later. I love Adventures in Wonderland, but they have some questionable morals sometimes. but that's what I find interesting about kids' shows is like looking at what are they telling kids on how to solve these problems, because it does end up influencing people. And in this one, I can't really say that anything goes on here that any morals are being taught. I mean, if you squint, yeah, there's sure there's morals, but I don't really know how like they're being addressed. Off the top of my head, I'm thinking, okay, they had one good moral that I can think of is this one episode where Hattie is making like this unusual cake is like had our tradition. And his friends assuming that he made it wrong, so they try to fix because it looks ugly, so they try to fix it for him. But actually, they ruined it because it's supposed to look that way. So they help him remake it. That one, I would say, is actually like that's a good moral. Like they don't really give anything to kids to try to prevent that misunderstanding. Like instead of messing with somebody's thing, ask if they want help, or something like that. They don't do that. Like it's more about fixing it, which involves a recipe.
I wonder if that's partly because of the fact that, like, yes, there are adults, but for the most part, there are no adults in this show. Like for the bulk of the show, there's not really an adult. Like they pop
Yeah,
up
the
once in a
adults don't
while.
really act like adults. They're more like big kids,
Yeah, kinda.
which is a little frustrating. Because some of these problems, it's just like talk to an adult. You need to talk to an adult, and it's but the adults are as unreliable as children are, which I guess is fair because it's Wonderland. but yeah, it doesn't help. Alice is probably the adultiest person there, and that's she's a child.
Yeah, kind of. I was gonna almost say Cookie, her cookbook is too, but
Oh, yeah.
She doesn't act adult enough at times too, like the one episode where she was gonna run away because she lost a recipe.
Yeah, that was ridiculous. I like, oh, I've made such, and that one in particular, oh, I've had such, like, this person's so important to me, so I'm gonna run away because I lost this important recipe to them. Great moral. Thanks, guys. I guess we could go into, we talked about how it doesn't really have anything to do with Alice Wonderland. It doesn't need to have anything to do with Alice Wonderland, but I guess we could talk about how it does have to do with Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah, I feel like that's going to be the most interesting thing to talk about is how it actually relates to Wonderland, because that was the thing that I had the most, the closest to fun that I had with this was figuring out what things were related to Wonderland and how, but also that was also confusing.
Yeah, I don't know. It's there's obviously a lot of references here, which, are not a bad thing, but it does kind of start becoming, I don't know, a reference for reference sakes. I have
Kind
mixed
of.
feelings.
Well, part of the problem was like I couldn't figure out what the timeline was supposed to be because I didn't think the timeline made any sense, especially with different things that people said about who they were potentially in relation to somebody else. It's like, is there supposed to be like a clear timeline as to when this took place, or is Wonderland like basically Narnia rules where it doesn't matter how much time is passing in the real world? A random amount of time has passed in Wonderland, like either way long or very short.
I mean, I don't remember them saying like a specific date or anything, but it implied to me that it's modern day.
Well, she's the great granddaughter of the original Disney Alice.
Yeah, everybody's great grandchildren of the quote unquote original characters.
I guess maybe that works. I think the thing that confused me the most was the family of the royal family, the Queen of Hearts, because like at first I thought the Queen and King of Hearts were married, but the King of Hearts is actually the Queen of Hearts' father. But then there's I was like, well, were they Cuban?
Yeah.
Okay, I was like, how did that work? But then I think there was a painting of her mother who was not Cuban, so I was like, well, the father must have married into the family, which is why she's the queen. But also the mother did not look at all like the original Queen of Hearts. She was weird looking.
Oh, no, I think her, no, I think the idea is that probably the Queen of Hearts ch children married people and then they had kids. And
Yeah.
so I don't
Oh.
know. I was kind of like, I could see that being a descendant.
Yeah. Well, the other one that didn't make sense was the Tweedles, because in this
I
show
never
it's
saw that one.
Tweedledoo and Tweedledon't. And one of the Tweedles said that he was like 6,000 years old, and the other one said she was older, but also they're Tweedles, so they're inherently ridiculous. So maybe that wasn't meant to be taken seriously. I don't
Yeah.
know.
One thing I will say, I was kind of like, huh, they never involved the March Hare. There's never a little, there's no little March Hare. But then I saw Hattie's family. And I was like, is this a gay couple?
I had that same thought, but then I watched it and well, I watched two different episodes with them. And the first episode, briefly, I was like, are Dad Hatter and the March Hare a couple? And they kind of acted like they were Hattie's parents, but then the March Hare never acted like that again. So it was just that one episode for his birthday.
I think they are kind of a couple, but they backed away from saying they are.
I suppose.
But I think, because I do think this was made a little bit before Disney's inclusivity, and that, and they're still making like new strides at that, and there's still a lot of pushback. So it's probably the right thing to do, not to be, controversial about this
Not to
one.
stir the pot, to put a
Yeah.
food metaphor on
But that
it.
said, I was like, that actually kind of makes sense because it would explain why there isn't a little March Hare.
Yeah, well, I mean,
They combined.
well, Hattie had to come from somewhere too, though. That's another thing. Other than them, if they are a couple, there were no families that I saw that had two parents. I know Disney likes to kill off parents, but like that's a high death rate if all of these parents had somebody die.
Oh no, Fergie has both parents.
Who?
Fergie, the white rabbit.
Oh, I must have missed. I didn't see his family.
Yeah, he has the episode about being picture perfect, and that you see both parents in that one.
Okay. One family had both parents survive somehow. But
Yeah.
like when the caterpillar family moves in, it's just the mom who's a butterfly. The dodo, it's just the dad.
I did see the Dodo episode, yeah.
Alice has no parents. That was another thing. What happened to Alice's parents? Did she just disappear from the real world and her parents have no idea where she is?
Yeah, it's I mean, let's talk about Alice. Okay, first off, I'm kind of annoyed she's American.
Oh, she is, isn't she? I didn't even think of
Yeah.
that. You're right.
On one hand, I guess this kind of goes along with like Catherine Beaumont's accent. You know, she was born in England, but having moved to America really young, she also got kind of a, I've heard it termed by some English people like a kind of a transatlantic twang to it.
I could see that. I never thought about it, but I think you're right.
Yeah, so I mean, you could do like the lore that the Disney Alice, she was English, but she had some American connection. So her descendants probably have an American connection as well. And maybe this Alice visited like the family estate and found her way into Wonderland or something. But it's never addressed because nothing is. But I don't know. It just kind of annoys me to have a fully American Alice. Maybe I just didn't like her voice. It was, you know, it just was the standard, this is a kid's show and I'm the main character kind of voice. Nothing special about it. Nothing awful either.
No.
The only person who had an English accent, kind of, was the doorknob, of
Craig
all things.
Ferguson plays the doorknob, so that's why.
Yeah, but the doorknob isn't English in the movie. I
Really?
No, he's not.
Oh, my
He has a
word.
goofy voice, but that's,
That's
it's supposed to be
hilarious.
the
I
same
didn't even think of
doorknob,
that.
right? He doesn't have children, does he?
No, it's from what I read, the doorknob and the Cheshire Cat are supposed to be the original characters from the movie,
Oh,
but
don't
they're
get
the
me
only
started on the
two.
Cheshire Cat. I'm so annoyed about what they did to Cheshire Cat.
I was kind of annoyed with his voice. Like, why not have Jim Cummings do the voice?
He sounds nothing like Sterling Holloway. I'm like,
No.
wait, this is supposed to be the original cat.
Yeah.
Why doesn't he have grandkids? This could have been avoided by saying he was a descendant as well. But, you know, like, okay, fine. You want that to be the original character, fine. Why does he sound nothing like him? There are people who could do Sterling Holloway impressions. They may not be as good as Sterling Holloway, but it's something.
No,
Is
nobody
Jim
is
Cummings not available?
exactly.
Is he retired?
Yeah, no, he's not retired. He still does tons of voice acting, so I don't, and tons of voice acting for Disney. Like, he still does all of Sterling Holloway's characters. So I was confused as to why they just didn't get him.
Yeah, I don't understand. And this that could have been explained away if it was a descendant. It didn't have to be the original cat, but they chose to make it the original cat, so I don't understand. You can't say that's the original character and then completely change his voice so it sounds nothing like him.
Yeah, it was strange.
It was very strange. I also think it's kind of strange that Alice's original, like regular outfit is Cheshire Cat coated with the pink stripes. I think that's also strange.
I didn't even think of that.
Yeah, I don't know. Well, I noticed it immediately when I saw the designs for it, and I was like, I guess that's a thing you could do, but why?
One thing I did like was that they had a lot of animals from the original movie. Although, one weird thing, there was an episode where I think there was a song. Yes. So there was an episode, actually, they had the Mock Turtle in an episode, which was surprising to me. His name was Jacques Tourtel, and he was a French chef. But he sang a song, and he named the bird that's a birdcage the Bandersnatch. And the umbrella birds were the Jub-Jub birds, which I had never put those together at all. And I'm not sure that was even the original intention when they made the original movie.
Sorry, what? The Jub-Jub birds?
The birds that are umbrellas, he named those as the Jub-Jub birds. Like when he sang about Jub-Jub birds in the song, they appeared on screen. And when he
I
sang
don't
about
think they're meant
Bandersnatch in
to
the
be
song,
the Jub-Jub birds, but I don't know.
that's what I was wondering. Like, I don't think that was the intention in the original movie.
Yeah, I don't think it is. I've never heard of it.
I mean, I guess it sort of makes sense. And I guess the birdcage does snatch other birds, so I guess it could be the Bandersnatch, but I don't know.
Guess they're not going to put in scary things in there.
Yeah.
That's what they put the Jabberwock, but he's a cute little dog-ish thing.
He was like a caterpillar puppy parrot.
Yeah.
It was a weird, like I was when I saw Jabberwocky in the title, I was like, oh, I gotta watch that one. And then that came up and I was like, oh. I was hoping it would be weirder, but instead it's just adorable.
Though, actually, that reminds me. So the way that the Royals have the Jabberwock actually kind of reminds me of the Bert and Alice. And there was something else that I watched this episode called Gallimongers Granola. I got stuck on the Gallimongers, and I was like, why? Why this word? It's not an Alice word, but it's itching as part of my brain. So I searched it up, and it's like, oh, and apparently it's inspired by the Disney Alice, but they also took some inspiration from the Bert and Alice. I was like, why? So Gallimongers is a word that was made up for the Bert and Alice, which explains why it sounded familiar, because I think they do say it in the film. I hate the word Gallimongers because it doesn't fit with Lewis Carroll's portmanteaus at all.
I feel like when we did the episode on that movie, you mentioned something about them trying to imitate his made-up words and hating the ones that they made up. That probably fits in with your feelings there.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's like, okay, Gallimongers, all his words like derived from previous words and are meant to be portmanteaus, and it doesn't look good to me. It doesn't sound good. It doesn't feel good to say. I just don't like it. But I just don't really understand why they want to bring anything for Burton. So it's like they have that word, and I think having the Jabberwocky as a pet and the way they go, like, my Jabberwocky, it's like, I think that's must be inspired by Burton as well. I just
Oh,
don't get
maybe. I didn't
why.
think of that.
I don't remember this as a baby, but like the way they were loving on it made me think, reminded me of the Queen of Hearts.
It could be.
Yeah, I feel like it's inspired as well.
Well, I read that it was partly inspired by the Bert and Alice, and I expected more overt references, and I didn't see any when I watched it. But I didn't watch the episode you're talking about.
There's probably more, but I haven't seen the whole show. I watched quite a bit of it. I
I watched
definitely
more
gave
than I
it
thought I was
a
going
chance.
to because I went in thinking, oh, I'll watch the first episode and then I'll watch the Catherine Beaumont episode. And then I started thinking, well, no, I probably should do a little bit more research, see how they portray all the different characters. So that's when I started skipping around and watching a bunch of episodes. But I watched a lot more than I expected to. I probably won't watch any more after this, but I feel like I got a good flavor of it.
Yeah, I think honorable mentions. I did like the potato potato episode. Did you see that one?
I watched the one where I don't remember what the recipe was they're making, something about habaneros, and then she mixed up tomatoes and potatoes. Is that what you're talking about?
No, that's something else.
Well, and that one was a weird episode because the queen ate the potato and then she started acting like a horse. And like the whole
Yeah.
episode after that was them trying to figure out how to save her by finding a magical carrot that would turn her back to normal. Oh, that was a weird episode.
Yeah, it was a weird episode. But no, not that one. Potato Potato is an episode where Fergie, the little white rabbit, which I hate the name Fergie, by the way.
Where did that come from? Like, what is
No
what?
idea. Fergus, maybe? Is that from Bert and Alice somewhere?
I thought his name was like McTwitter Wisp or something. Something fantastical. I don't remember. I don't think it
I
was anything
don't
normal.
know. Alice in Wonderland, Fergus. Is there Fergus? In the no, I get the Fergus from Brave, so I guess not. I have no idea where they got Fergus from.
Nivens McTwisp is his name in the Tim Burton film.
Yeah,
So it's not
I don't
that.
know. All I know is I hate the name Fergie. I'll
It
say that.
was it sounded like something that was supposed to be super cute and I didn't understand the reference.
Yeah, he and Alice are supposed to be making. Sorry, they're supposed to be making different recipes at the same time. Like, oh, they use the same ingredients, but we call them different things. Hence the name potato potato. And then it turns out they made the same recipe with different names, and that the reason why they both know this recipe is that their great grandparents, Alice and the original White Rabbit, made this recipe together, and they just both called it different things, which is I thought it was actually pretty cute. And there's some artwork of them together with the recipe.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, Alice and Rabbit are friends. We're friends. They're dead now. But anyway, so it's like, I don't know. I liked that episode. And then I liked the very last one I watched, where they take care of the Jabberwock for the royal family. And that one I only liked because, oh, we haven't mentioned it yet, but this show has a lot of songs, most of which, in my opinion, are not very good.
Yeah.
The only ones that are good are the ones you hear that they reuse, like Let's Bake and Food for Thought. Food for Thought has actually been on my brain for the past few days, and I blame you. kidding. That one's actually pretty decent, but whatever. Anyway, so they're about to sing the Let's Bake, and I'm like, oh, here we go. The structured, it's time to sing the songs, so we're gonna sing it. And then just as they're singing, the Jabberwock comes crashing through on the counter, crashing their things over, interrupting them, and I actually laughed really, really hard at that because I wasn't expecting it. I was like, "Well, good job. You had set up expectations for me, and then changed my mind. Surprised me." Also, in that episode, it was combined with Easy Breezy, which was when there's like a tornado, or not a tornado, her like wind going around the palace because of a recipe they messed up, or the queen messed up, and.
Oh, yeah, I thought I did see that one.
Yeah, the throne's talking this, and the chair just randomly goes, "Hello." When he like, okay, somebody storyboarding this had humor, that kind of was able to inch its way through. But that's another. You know what? This show doesn't have charm. That's what it's missing for me. And I was like,
Yeah.
here we go. Some it's charm in this episode, and I'm gonna grab it. Just some personality, it's like I'm talking to a person.
Yeah.
And so those were two really small moments in this one episode. And there might be other episodes where that comes through, but that was the first time for me going through like 20 of them, or 15 to 20. Any other episodes you liked before we actually start into the episodes we most saw?
Well, there's not really any specific episodes other than, like, the main reason that I wanted to talk about this was Alice's first day in Wonderland. But I did find one that I think you might have watched after I told you about it through.
Yeah,
Oh,
I
now
did.
what was it called? I don't remember. It had a looking glass in the title.
Looking Glass Leap.
Something like that.
Yeah, I didn't think the title made a lot of sense, to be honest.
Well, the reason that I've felt like we should talk about that one was because through watching all the other episodes, I was like, yes, this is odd, but it doesn't feel like Wonderland. Like, it's not the correct flavor of ridiculousness for Wonderland. It just didn't feel, it felt like a weird magical world, but it did not feel like what you would think of with Wonderland. It wasn't nonsensical enough. But then
Yeah.
when they go through the looking glass, I felt like they were so much closer to what it should feel like. It wasn't quite there, but it was so much closer.
Yeah. I think a big part of that is that so Looking Glass Leap is what it's called. And a big part of that is just they were able to step away from the original Disney film as an inspiration. But also they weren't leaning on the Burt and Alice either. They were just kind of doing their own thing, inspired by the books, I feel like. And I feel like that added a lot more to it. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Well, also the Silver Queen also felt almost like the White Queen. Not quite, but close.
I actually thought, for people listening, Silver Queen is the only queen in this episode in the Looking Glass Land, or whatever they call it, the Looking Glass. And I feel like she actually had characteristics of both the Red and White Queens. It made me wonder if perhaps She's like the descendant of both of them. At some point, their families intermarried.
Oh,
It's
maybe.
possible because they're both supposedly royal. But she had, she was very nice, but she had moments where like kind of like serious nonsense, which is very Red Queen in my opinion. And at some point, I just want to point out, because I felt like this was a reference, which was just like, and it like knocked me in the gut, because I was shocked. So Alice says, "You know, silverness or something," and she says, "Oh, call me Sylvie," which obviously is a play on silver. But I was like, "Oh my God, it's a Sylvie reference to Sylvia Bruno,"
Oh my
and
word.
yeah, I was, "Oh
I
my
wonder if
God,
that
it's
was
like
intentional.
it had to be intentional." I was like, "This is a Carol reference, but like pure Carol. It's not Alice," and I was shocked, you know. It came out of left field for me. I was not expecting that. So I feel like that was on purpose. I don't know if the person who named her realized Sylvia Bruno. I don't know if they read Sylvia Bruno. I don't know if they just saw a list of Carol's work, which is like, Sylvie works. Sylvie sounds like silver. Yeah, we could do that. But I feel like it was intentional, especially since this episode was a bit more like, I feel like this episode in general was a bit more like the books in a way, because they weren't relying on the Disney Alice.
Yeah, that's why I specifically thought we should talk about this one, because it just felt closer. Not completely, but it felt
Yeah.
closer to what you would expect from Wonderland, from the works of Lewis Carroll.
Yeah, and even like the second story of the episode, I don't remember what the second story was called, but it was also had to do with Looking Glass Land and the Silver Queen, where they make a recipe by unmaking it. And I was
Oh,
like,
I must not have
again, at the
watched the
very,
second half. I because I
you
don't
didn't
remember
watch the
that,
second?
but I must not have. But that
Oh, I should
does,
have.
I should have, yeah. That what you're describing though sounds close to what the White Queen would have been like.
Yeah, and I mean, well, there's that portion in the Looking Glass where Alice has to spread around the bread or the cake by not cutting it, you
Oh,
know,
that
doing it
too.
backwards.
Yeah.
So, a very clear what Looking Glass reference, and I was like, this is pretty surprising, and I actually probably would have liked the show in more in general if it was more like this.
Me too. When I watched that, I was like, I wish the whole show were like this.
I feel like I don't know, maybe because they were kind of like booked in to be inspired by the Disney Alice, it was a little like too, they were too like married to it. And so at this point, when they took a step back and it was just like, let's look for inspiration from the books, it felt a lot better, and they were able to kind of do their own thing. And
Yeah.
so, yeah. So, my opinion, this was the best episode I saw. I might go see if the Silver Queen shows up again and
She
in any other
does.
episode.
She does.
Okay.
Because I watched a different one after I watched that one that was later on in the series, and she was in that one too. The one with the mock turtle, I believe she might have been at that one. Or she, well,
Okay.
they went to the Looking Glass Land because that's where they found him. Because
All right.
he had left Wonderland because he made calamity soup and accidentally spilled it on the newborn baby Princess of Hearts. And then he was so embarrassed, he got depressed and he left forever. But they brought him back and found out everybody actually loved the calamity soup and now he's a hero, whatever. It was kind of dumb,
Okay.
but I kind of liked the character a little bit.
I guess that's why that was their try to explain why he wasn't in the Disney movie, basically.
Oh no, because it was because the princess that he spilled on was the princess that's there now, Rosa.
Oh, okay. All
Yeah,
right. Well,
he spilled on her when she was a baby and then he was so upset he left.
that would have been interesting if they had done that.
Yeah. I was hoping that there would be a griffin. And I because when he showed up, I was like, ooh, are we going to get a griffin too? And then there was no griffin.
Well, the show's still being made. I don't know. Maybe.
Oh, that's true. Maybe they will.
So there were a couple other things in that episode that I wanted to point out. The way they incorporate the Looking Glass is also, I feel like, clever, because there is a mirror in the Disney Alice rabbit hole where she goes past it and her up reflection is upside down.
Oh, you're
Which it was
right. I
here.
forgot about that.
Yeah, so it's like very nice. Even though part of what makes the episode better is that they move away from Disney Alice, it's a nice tie back to be like, we could justify this because there's a mirror in here in the movie. Once she goes through the mirror, she comes out on like this blue ribbon. And I don't know about you, but I was like, Blue Road from the 1966 through the Looking Glass Alice. And I was like, I don't know if that was purposeful. It probably not.
The one that it reminded me of was the 2012 Looking Glass, the French version. The whole place reminded me of that.
Oh, it reminded me of that too, but I assume that had to be a coincidence.
Oh, probably.
Yeah. Another one, actually, I think the blue ribbon is kind of also in the 1966 Hanna-Barbera Alice as well. So it could be a reference to either one, or it could just be completely their own thing. But I thought that was kind of cool, if so. Probably their own idea, probably coincidence. So you watched the other episode, Looking Glass, anything else interesting?
Well, there was a couple other things that I forgot I was going to mention too. There was a frog footman in some episodes,
Mm.
no Duchess that I saw, but I thought it was interesting that they had a frog footman.
Oh yeah.
And then, like I mentioned before, there was a caterpillar family, a child caterpillar named Saeed, and his mother, who was a butterfly, who were supposed to be Persian. And I thought, well, I guess this is the descendants of the caterpillar. And I thought it was kind of weird that they decided to go Middle Eastern. I was like, is that just because he had a hookah? I was like, okay, whatever.
I mean, yeah, I think it's a common connection to some Alice Wonderland annotations.
Oh, it is. It is. But
Yeah.
like, just specifically for this, there was nothing in the original movie that said that the caterpillar was supposed to be,
Middle Eastern.
well, I guess you would say Iranian now, not. Like it on the line, they were calling the caterpillars Persian, but it's Iran that was Persia. But anyways, I never got that from the Disney caterpillar. But then in another episode, I was looking at IMDb and I was like, oh, Anna Gasteyer's on here. I like her. I should watch an episode with her. And her character was named Kiki, and I saw Kiki in the name of an episode. So I was like, I'll watch that one and see what her character's like. It looked like a gender swapped caterpillar. It was like almost the exact same as the Disney caterpillar, except female. So I was like,
There was also like a caterpillar-ish thing in a copycat episode where I don't know if it was meant to be a caterpillar relative, but I actually assumed it was because it looks like a caterpillar. He's like blue, little nerdier looking though.
maybe it's just the caterpillar has so many descendants. I don't know. I just thought that
Yeah.
was interesting that. Because I assumed that Saeed and his mother were supposed to be descendants of the caterpillar, but I also thought it was weird that they didn't have the same amount of legs. They only had two legs and or no, four legs and two arms, which I thought was okay, whatever. I guess he lost limbs as he had descendants. But then Kiki had a ton of legs and a ton of arms. So I don't know.
I guess they don't call any of them his descendants directly, do they?
No, they don't. Not at least what I watched, they did not.
Oh my gosh, I just looked up Kiki, you're right. It looks exactly like him.
Because like I assumed, because even though Saeed and his mother don't look too much like the caterpillar, Saeed has like a curly hair thing going on, so it was like, yeah, similar, I guess. But like Kiki has that too, but it's part of her head, like the caterpillar.
I'm confused. She's not a descendant.
I don't know. I have no idea. I assumed that Saeed and his mother were, but then she showed up
It looks like she's
and
blowing bubbles in these screen caps too. I haven't seen this
she is.
episode,
She is.
which
That's
makes
one of
me
her
think she's
things.
a descendant,
Yeah.
right?
She must be.
She
But
must be.
I don't know how Saeed and his mother fit in then. They're just unrelated, I guess. They did move there at the beginning of the episode, but they also said they moved from Dodo Beach. So I don't know. There's a lot of things that just don't make sense in this show.
I don't know. There's some thing like some choices here where I'm just like, I don't know why they chose to do this.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know why they chose to start the first episode kind of like meeting Rosa, the Princess of Hearts, but then a year later supposedly like, oh, let's talk about the first time she actually went to Wonderland. Like, why? Why didn't you do that first?
I wondered that too. It would have made more
That would
sense
have
to
been kind of
explain,
nice.
yeah, explain why she was there. And again, I want to know why she doesn't have parents. Did she have parents in the real world that she has just abandoned? to live in Wonderland permanently?
I choose to believe she abandoned them. Who can blame her? No rent. You just make, and she's into, by the way, she has like a hyper focus on baking.
Yeah.
She's just like, these people love it when I bake for them. So her family's like, please, Alice, we can't eat all this. You can't just put buttercup flowers and say it's butter into a recipe.
Oh,
That's
that's right.
not
I was
how it
going to
works.
mention that too. Did they steal that from Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory?
I don't know. Definitely, you know, wink, wink. Though you could argue that buttercup is pretty
It is. But
obvious,
I
I
thought it looked
guess.
too very similar to the
Yeah.
one that Willy Wonka eats.
Anyway, her family's like, you can't do that, Alice. And she's like, screw it, I'm gonna go to Wonderland.
Well, yeah, let's talk about the Alice's first day in Wonderland. The reason that I have decided that we should do this show to begin with, because the main reason that I wanted to talk about this was they made a huge deal about, oh, the original Alice is returning. Catherine Beaumont is coming back to voice her character in the new Alice's Wonderland Bakery show. And I was like, oh, that's great. Because, like, when they made Return to Neverland, she voiced Wendy, and then they replaced her. And I thought that was a travesty. Not that Return to Neverland was that great of a movie, but like the fact that they got rid of her and replaced her with a different voice actress after she'd already done all the work, that annoyed me a lot.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, she gets some redemption. And then I watched in the show, and granted, this is a better episode than the other, so I was more invested in it. I was like, when is she going to show up?
This one was a better episode, actually. I will say that.
Yeah. And she had one line.
Yeah.
I was so annoyed.
Yeah, just one line. It would have been cool to see like her in the Wonderland Bakery or something, because
Yeah.
supposedly that's how she designed her bakery. So it's not like, oh, I like too modern or something. Just have her, I don't know, memory back then or something.
Yeah, that's what I thought they were gonna do, because they had the whole they went down memory lane, which is an actual lane, and then they were watching this video. I don't know what it was. So some sort of Wonderlandish version of video that was memory. I was like, oh, this is how they're gonna bring the original Alice back. And you didn't even see her.
Yeah.
You just had a voiceover of her reading an inscription in Cookie, the cookbook.
Yeah.
It's like, what? This is what
I
I've
mean,
been
that's
waiting for?
the line she reads. My goodness, she sounds so much older. And
She did. I mean, she technically
yeah.
is a lot older, but I don't know. From what I've heard online, people kept saying, oh, she just sounds like she did just back then. Her voice has barely changed at all. Not that it needed to
No.
sound the same. It's fine that she sounded older, but I guess I was expecting her to sound a lot closer to how she sounded back then.
When I say older, I mean like
Like an appropriate amount of time has passed.
I don't just mean older, like maybe too old to go back to voice acting, which I guess she is retired.
Well, yeah, but I mean, I don't know. It's not that important, but I don't know. I just thought it was weird that they made such a big deal about her coming back, and
And it was one line, yeah.
yeah.
I was expecting something a little bit more. I didn't even have anything to say about it. I just wrote the line, which is which, by the way, so I wrote, Kathy sounds so much older. And then I wrote what she says is, if you found yourself in Wonderland, then you'll find yourself in Wonderland, which means what?
I think it's I don't know, it's probably supposed to be kind of deep, like someone finding themselves.
Yeah.
So like figuring out who they are. So if you found yourself in, it's a play on words. If you found yourself
Yeah.
in Wonderland, then you will find yourself in Wonderland. But
But I
sure, I
argue,
guess, whatever.
does the new Alice really find herself in Wonderland?
She has the least amount of character development of anybody in the show so far, I think. I don't
Exactly.
know that
I
she
was like,
learns
after I
anything.
thought that, I was actually like, is this supposed to be about her journey? Because she's the one who's helping everybody else.
Yeah, I don't know.
So I'm kind of like, I don't understand. Is she supposed to have an arc? I was like, I don't get it.
Probably not. That's technically a preschooler show. I think we're analyzing
Yeah.
this more than anybody ever will.
Even the like, okay, so she has basically her very good advice scene, Except
Yeah,
it
I
was
thought
called
that
the,
too. The it was just like a basically that scene, but with the new Alice. Even with the creatures showing up.
and with a much worse song. So
Yeah.
it's the Who Am I song, and I wrote boring and pointless.
It was pretty much supposed to be a callback to that scene for an audience that won't appreciate it with a worse song.
It just felt so forced. It's not a, okay, this episode, I'd say it was a pretty good episode overall, but I think the problem here is that it probably should have been a special. Go a little bit more, like, give it a little bit more length.
Actually show the original Alice.
Yeah, well, I don't know about that, but in terms of, like, being a good episode, telling a story,
That
I
would have
think they
helped it
should
be
have
a
given
better
out the
episode
pr
for me.
sure. They should have, forget the premise about this lost recipe. Because for anybody who's listening and you haven't seen the show, basically the idea is Alice has been here for a whole year, so her friends are kind of, they're trying to celebrate her, and Cookie, the anthropomorphic cookbook who also knew the original Alice, it's like, oh, let's remake her first recipe, Wonder Cake, but she lost the recipe. And so they go down memory lane and watch this cinema memory thing to find out where they put the recipe, and that's where you actually see Alice's first day, and that's when it gets good. So things I got some things in there. I like that she also followed a rabbit. She followed Fergie.
Yes.
Which, by the way, sorry, side note, I think Fergie likes Alice in this. I think he has a crush, and I feel like it's on purpose.
It could be. I didn't think of that, but I wasn't looking for anything like that, so I'm
Anyway, so she follows Fergie. The doorknob, I wrote, the doorknob doesn't suck in this, and he lets her through immediately. Fair enough. You see on the table that that stuff is there. It's just like, nah, I've seen this play out before. I'm not interested. Go through. I'm unlocked this time. And she's chasing him because she wants to help his cake, because his dates are slipping on the cake, and she's like, it's your buttercream. Like, she wants to help him. That said, she also calls him cute, and I'm like, oh my God, are they meant to be a couple? And anyway, comes across the Hatter family and March Hare, who's totally the other dad. And Hattie invites they invite her to tea. They also show the half a cup joke, which comes up in every single Disney Alice version ever. It was in the Disney Alice, it was in Adventures Wonderland, and it was in this more than once. And then the path dog isolates her, so that's when she has the told you would bootleg, very good advice scene. Except it's a horrible song. Who am I? I hated it. Then she the cat directs her to the bakery, and that's interesting considering the cat is the original cat. So it makes me think the cat recognized her as Alice. Or Alice's descendant, I mean. So he directed her there. She shrinks and grows in the bakery. And I like that they even have her quote, "Goodbye, feet."
I like that too, yeah.
Yeah, I do not like how she looks in the bakery grown up. It wasn't designed for her being grown in. You could tell. They don't do anything fun with it. And then she meets the cookbook, and like the book writes this. On it says this book belongs to Alice in Wonderland, and the title page, I don't know why, but the font and design remind me a lot of Tennille Alice's that I've seen, so I kind of like that. Probably not purposeful, but I don't know, for me it just hit something for me. That's all I have really, besides Wonder Cake tastes like the drink me bottle when they make it over, but that's it. The good part ends abruptly because,
Yes.
like, oh, the memory's fading and they're back to present day. And Alice is like, oh, well, I remember where the recipe is now. And I'm like, what? But it was so good. You're gonna stop there? No. Why would you do this to me? And then they make the recipe, and I don't know why the drink me bottle is. Taste is like the Wonder Cake, whatever. I don't care anymore. Who cares? So it's a good episode, but it's only good because the middle part's good, and they kind of gave up on it.
It did seem like that.
Yeah, and meanwhile, by the way, Cookie By the way, anyways, not listening, who hasn't watched it, Cookie's like, oh, I have to leave now because I've lost the first recipe I made with both Alice's, and that's really important to me. It's very important to me, and so I'm gonna leave. Like, you overdramatic, you know, it's just.
It's like the scene from Revenge of the Sith where Yoda says that he must go into exile. I must go.
Yeah, and then there's a reprise of the bad song too, and Alice is like, you know, I know who I am now, and it's like I don't know who you are. I really, you know, actually it's good. I liked the episode at the time, though I didn't like the end of it. But it's making me more upset the more I think about it because I feel like if they had just taken that middle bit and made it its own thing, it would have been so much better. But yeah, it wouldn't have hurt if we saw the original Alice, like a memory of her. That actually would have been interesting. My idea. Okay, first episode is a special where she actually goes to Wonderland and Cookie wants to make a recipe that she made with the original Alice to like show her something special to her great grandmother, and they go down memory lane, and then she sees the memory with Alice. That would have been nice. But, you know, I don't know. I'm upset.
There's so many ways that we've talked about that they could have made the show better if they'd just done them.
Yeah.
They should have hired
Which you
us.
could argue it's not for us. And that's like,
No,
okay,
yeah.
fine.
I kept saying to myself, this is not, I'm not the target audience. I'm assuming that the target audience will like this because it is colorful.
At the same time, does the target audience like this?
I
Because
don't
I was
know.
thinking about it.
I don't know anyone who watches it, so I don't know.
You know, I work in a place where I see a lot of children who like Disney things, and I've never ever seen a child dressed as this Alice or any of the characters. And I've never even seen them carry a toy from the show. Are that said, like I actually, if we look at Shop Disney right now, so I collect the Disney little like playset figures. So I was like, even before I watched the show, I was like, well, I'll get that when it comes out because, you know, I collect the playsets in the first place, and also it's Alice related, so whatever, I'll get it. I won't be happy about it, but I'll get it. And they never did. They never did. So I'm like, is this okay? Right now on shopdisney.com, I looked up Alice's Wonderland Bakery. Nothing. There's nothing.
Weird. A lot of these shows are made with merchandise in mind. Like, they gotta sell
Yeah.
something.
I thought they at least had like a cook playset, but I guess maybe they don't anymore. So I'm like, is this show appealing to its target audience? They're still
I
making
don't know.
episodes though, right? Like, so I don't understand. Because if it's not, then why don't they put it out of its misery?
I'm too far removed from the target audience that I have no idea. I just, watching it, it did not really appeal to me, other than the fact that it's Alice and I enjoyed looking for references and that's it. But like, I just assumed based on like how colorful it is and probably the songs that little kids would like this. But I don't know. Like, I don't
Yeah.
know any little kids who would watch this, so.
Okay, it looks like there are some toys. There's a doll, and then there's like baking playsets, which is pretty standard. And some plushies of Alice and the Dinah. Oh, Rosa, Cheshire Cat. There is a playset, but it was never through Shop Disney. So I mean, there are things, but I have to wonder how popular, you know, quote unquote popular these things are.
Yeah, I don't know.
Like even searching up Alice's Wonderland Bakery in Google, I have to specifically put in toys because nothing is coming up. Like besides like the show wiki and stuff. So I don't know. I don't know, maybe we're wrong. Maybe there are some hardcore huge fan base and they're just all hiding. I never see them.
Yeah, I don't know. It's hard to know with the little kid shows because the little kids aren't the ones making the purchasing decisions.
I don't know. I can see them. Sometimes you see a kid and they're all decked out, and he's like, okay, well, I know what their favorite show is.
Well, true. I meant like they're not the ones with the money, the parents are. But like,
Yeah.
well, you work at Disneyland, so do you see kids like in Mickey Mouse Clubhouse gear? Well, that would be like on the similar, I don't know, target audience.
Well, that one's a little hard to distinguish what's Mickey Mouse Clubhouse and what's just Mickey Mouse.
True, I guess.
Though I would argue Mickey Mouse Clubhouse is also a little outdated because the current show is Mickey Mouse Roadsters or whatever.
Oh, so it's fully. I knew that that was a new one, but I didn't realize Mickey Mouse Clubhouse was not a thing anymore. I thought it was still going
I mean,
on.
it's still re-showing, but the current one is the Roadsters one, which that's probably dead now too. I don't know. I have seen kids wear things with just like the Mickey Mouse and the Roadsters gear. Also, ironically, so we redid Toontown, and we have a music loop that now pl plays like a Mickey Mouse Clubhouse theme song and Hot Dog, and it's incredible how many people will sing along to those two tracks, including adults, without even realizing it. They'll just be like,
Probably the parents who've heard it a million times and it has burned itself into their brain.
yeah, it's like, but even the because we have some songs from the Goofy movie in there too. Even those don't get sing along as much as the song that gets the most sing along is Mickey Mouse Clubhouse theme song. But anyway, that one's a diff I think that one's a little difficult because if people are wearing Mickey Mouse gear all the time, I could tell you. I think the most popular thing right now is Encanto. I've
That makes
seen
sense.
kids like absolutely decked out in Encanto, and you could tell they have a favorite character. Like, I saw this kid the other day, he was wearing like lime green glasses, like Mirabelle, and was carrying, wearing a shirt and carrying an Antonio doll, which I was like, I didn't even know they made Antonio dolls. And so it's, I don't know. You can tell when kids are into something, but I can't say I've seen anything Alice's Wonderland Bakery, not even a toy. That said, like, don't bring your kids' toys to Disneyland because they will lose them. Yeah. So anyway, I don't think I have anything else to say about the show, unless you want to really go into nitty gritty.
My only other thing, really, of note was the fact that they had dancing dodo eggs as an ingredient, and I was like, are they eating a sentient species babies?
Endangered sentient species babies.
Because, like, dodos are characters in this show. There's the father
Yeah.
who's a sailor and like Jojo Dodo, the baby girl. Like,
Yeah.
so what, could this have potentially been her siblings and they're just cracking them into a cake?
Yeah, I guess. One more note. I really dislike that the princess says, I heard this, and it's
I
ages,
thought the
and
same thing, and I was like, that's very hypocritical of me to hate this because I have a podcast called I Heart Movies and I Heart Animation. But I was so annoyed by
yeah, but she
that. I don't
doesn't.
know why.
You don't do that in conversation. You're like, oh, I have a show called I
Maybe
Heart This,
that's
and it's like,
why. Maybe that's why, because
yeah,
she
where
used
she's
it
just
so.
like, yeah, she's like, I heart that like all the time. And I'm like, oh.
Yeah, I think that's probably why, because it is something that you see in text. It's not something you say in conversation. That's probably why it rubbed me the wrong way. Because like even with me,
Yeah.
I have it more of like it's the heart emoji rather than spelling it out. Because I did that for a while and I put the emoji in instead. It's more a text-based thing.
Actually, just focusing on Rosa in general, she's like really disconnected from the other characters. Like she's a third tier psychic.
Yeah, I thought that too, but also she is royal and like, not that this show needs to make sense, but she would have things that she would have to do. She can't just be
I
running
guess.
around the Wonderland forest with animals all day.
But I mean, like she doesn't even have a line in the Let's Bake song. How much of a person are you if you don't have your solo line in the Let's Bake song? You know? Said it like a rabbit, can't be late. She doesn't have that. Just saying.
Yeah, I don't know. Again, I feel like we're probably analyzing this far more than even the people who made it are.
Obviously. So again, my analogy, it's like a pool. It's not the best, but it's okay. It's not for me. That said, I might watch a few more episodes and maybe I doubt I'll change my mind, but
No, I feel the same way, and I don't plan on watching anymore, but if you find something that you think is interesting, let me know, because I would like to see if they ever do like a Griffin or the Duchess, because I am curious. Like, they brought
yeah.
in the Frog Footman, they brought in the Mock Turtle. I am
I think there
curious
were
about
fish in the
more.
first episode in the audience too. Like,
Oh yeah, fish, lobsters, birds,
yeah.
parrots.
I don't know. I might watch more. Particularly, there was something about like more Japanese episodes I haven't seen yet.
Oh, I started watching one and then I was bored and I was like, I need to focus on ones that don't bore me this much. But
Ooh, that's not
Hattie's
good.
family is Japanese and they had like
Yeah.
a tea thing going on and they were like a cherry blossom festival or something. I don't know. I didn't
Oh,
watch a lot of it.
that's why. I was like, huh, why are the Hatters Japanese? It's like, oh, tea. Okay. I got it now.
I didn't
But
even think about that.
yeah, that took a while. That took a few weeks.
That's a random thing to latch on to and be like, T, let's make them Japanese.
Yeah. Or I enjoy it a little bit more if they went into like he's because I feel like it'd be kind of cute to have a half Japanese, half I don't know, Western or something.
I thought you were going to say half Japanese, half March hair. I was like, that doesn't exactly work.
He should be half March hair.
I mean, it's Wonderland. It doesn't need to biologically make
We
sense.
don't know how they reproduce. Can't prove me wrong. We don't know. Maybe he is March hair. She doesn't just it's a recessive gene. I don't know. Oh man. Anyway, so sorry, but listen, I look forward to our next recording about Adventures in Wonderland, which is a show I really, really like. And also, I look forward to being hypocritical about some points, so that'll be fun.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that too, because I have not seen that since I was a little kid, and I'm curious as to how it holds up and if I will enjoy it, because I don't remember much about it. I just remember watching a few episodes when I was really little.
Yeah, that's kind of everybody. They just remember that it existed.
Yeah.
Anyway, yeah, this one, it's okay. There are worse things. There are worse adaptations.
Yeah.
It could be better.
Yeah, I pretty much feel the exact same way.
Yeah, and if your kid likes it, that's fine.
Yeah. Okay, well, until next time when we talk about a better Disney adaptation, do you want to let people know where they can find you if they want more from you?
Sure. So I'm Phantomwise on YouTube for my Alice content, and Love Gets of a Fairy Tale for my anything else content,
Okay.
which isn't much. Bye.
Well, we will see you hopefully soon. Thanks for listening to Wonderland Wednesday. If you enjoyed this episode, make sure to subscribe and follow my co-hosts as well. My link tree and all of our links will be in the description below. If you want more of my content, all my podcasts are available on YouTube as well as most podcast platforms. If you enjoyed this show, check out one of the other podcasts or check out my Patreon for bonus and extended episodes you won't find anywhere else. We'll be back soon with another brand new episode, so thanks for listening and we'll see you next time.